Hello. Good evening, everyone. My name is Kennedy Lockheed. First of all, I would like to welcome you all to MOSAIC 2017. Today, I'll start my introduction part. We have Dr. Alex Akhu, Assistant Professor Mumbai Campus, Tata Institute of Social Science. He's also the chairperson of Center for Social Justice and Governance School of Social Work. He will be chairing our talk for this evening. And we have our main speaker today, Mr. Kaustubh, Deka. He's from Assam, he's presently settling in Delhi. He did his MA MPhil and PhD from JNU. And he has a lot of publication, and he has also presented a lot of papers in both national and international seminars. He was formerly an assistant professor at IP College for Women in Delhi University, and he's currently associating with public policy scholars at his Hindu Center for Politics and Policies. And he's also involved with various international bodies like UNDP, UNDP as a consultant. His area of interest is social movement. His area of interest are social movement, identity politics, youth politics and empowerment, and developmental studies. For quite a long time, we have been listening to a series of veteran speakers, and we are lucky to have this time a new and young, and we will be listening from that to a contemporary voice this time. And without taking much of my time, I'd like to start with the presentation. I'll request our Alex to hand over the presentation to Tata Institute of Social Science show to our speaker.
Points of view, which oftentimes I put in my writings as
perspectivology or perspectivism. This is very significant to understand because one has to be very careful, especially as a scientist. We need to understand the frames that come, the frames that categorize us, the frames, epistemological frames, the political frames that come onto us, and constantly is turning the area. And of course, in we should engage with this kind of frames in an attempt to allow life, allow diversity to be lived, allow peace, development. So I think if we are change makers, we need to first engage at the frame, and I definitely feel that this concept that we have chosen is an apt concept to begin with. Now, of course, Northeast is a big geographical area, as you know, and it is a very strategic place and generally referred to as frontiers in the earlier times. Today, some concepts are changing. People talking about bridge, gateways. But it is a huge place in that sense, having a very definite and very specific geopolitical context and socio-cultural diversity. To begin with, I just wanted to introduce you some of the few concepts or literatures that I've come across and which is, to my mind, helping me to understand some of this you know, frame that we are talking about. And in that sense, the first thing that I remember whenever I talk about Northeast is the book Political System of Highland Burma, way back 1954 in the 50s. So, Manleach, a famous socio-anthropologist, was written about the Chins and the Sans, and he talks about the political system of the Highland Burma. I thought that is very fundamental, very dynamic equilibrium that we're talking about, of looking at a society, and for the first time taking a departure from the colonial essentialist understanding of a society and culture. And of course, once we enter the post-colonial times, we have, before that you have the colonial writers with so many books out here, I don't want to go into it, but to give you a sense. Once you come into the post-colonial times, we have some of the nationalists, including the colonial administrators like Alvin Barrier. We have his book, The Philosophy of Nefa, 1957, very well known there. Wherein in the foreword of that book is prescribed the fundamental principles of tribal development. And then you have in the mainland the nationalist, Indian nationalist, one of them which I remember. Important to understand our area is Alvin Barrier. I know this Gurier, G.S. Gurier. He's a sociologist from here, Mumbai University itself. And you know his way of looking at tribes, and in fact his approach to building a nation of a kind, which is falling within the whole Vedic philosophy. The approach to national building was definitely assimilation. And in fact, they say that when Alvin Barrier went to the Northeast, he realized things were very different. So he started talking about, there only he started realizing that we need to talk of different thing in context of Northeast. And generally today we refer to us two approaches that we have, what we call as political integration and political integration. On the other side, on the tribal area, usually two approaches were laid down, that is cultural assimilation and political assimilation. But for the Northeast, generally it was referred to as a political integration. That is one fundamental departure. And by 60s, these are 60s, and you have a huge debate on tribes and autonomy, and there are other altogether things which will take a lot of time, but just I want to show you how things have been debated, how frames have been made. So I'm just highlighting some things. By 2000, you have new energies and waves of articulations that's coming up. In fact, you have a local person, indigenous persons writing and articulating their theories, critiquing And in that process, some of the books, of course, not the local ones, but you have, just now, what comes to my mind is Sandeep Barua is a political scientist, of course, he writes a lot on that, on ethno-nationalism and the political processes. You have him as well, important person. In fact, latest is talking about understanding Northeast from the viewpoint of citizenship and interstate relationship or international relationships. And you have, other people like James Ford, you have Sanders, you have Duncan, you have Carlson, all lots of people who started coming and talking about this area. And in fact, I'm sometimes worried about the way how literatures are, books are written, how concepts are created, how frameworks are created. And we need to be aware of this as a social scientist. And in my opinion, the way how things have been looked at, especially people coming from outside and writing about the Northeast, is usually it is looked at from understanding global capital and globalization and the process like that. In fact, James Watt, although is a very famous and quoted often to describe the qualities of that kind, but he makes a point, says in that book, if you look at today, finally, these people have been fleeing from the state, trying to fend for themselves, to flee from the clutches of the state. He says that these are finally moving very slowly, slowly. They are not able to defend themselves because of the process of globalization, you know. And concrete terms, you know, now there are roads, there are, you know, different ways of. There's no place, no jungle, no jung cultivation that you can do over there. It's, you know, it has become, you know, in fact, latest Duncan talks about Imphal to Moray. Imphal, usually these are frontier regions. Now today is talking, people are talking about gateway. A frontier which was a fence, now today is talked about a gateway. A gateway to Southeast Asian countries. And in fact, that is definitely falling within the framework of what we call look east, no? Look east policy that we have, the Indian government policy also. So they are falling somewhere down the line, whether, you know, somewhere they are converging as an idea. And in fact, if you look at the writing that's coming, especially from government perspective, the focuses are on governance, the focuses are on development, and governance. These are some of the things that's coming. But if you look at very closely, you will see that there are a perspective that's coming there. One is talking about a political integration. As long as the North is concerned, it's a part of India. It should not break up to other countries. So it's part of India. So you still talk about a political integration. But at the level of the development or economy, they are talking about diversification. So we can't talk about Northeast developing it by putting Delhi as a center, you know, and we are the periphery. Now, people are talking, we need to diversify the economy, and they need to be connected economically across the region. In fact, I still remember last year, we have during the MOSAIC, our friend Subir Bhaumik has come here and delivered a lecture on the whole economic corridor that we are talking about. So, you see, most of the time, you see, especially scholars coming from outside are targeting on trying to understand what is the capital, how does it work, how does globalization impact on this at the local level. In fact, if I may quote Carlson, if you see the book of Carlson, The Unruly Hills, you see that there's on the cover there is one dried tree there. That hill is supposedly the Siloam Peak. Siloam Peak is a sacred grove, but today what remains of this sacred grove is only a dried tree. That is the impact of the global capital they're talking about. But what I'm concerned about is, definitely our speaker will be talking about this thing, adversity. While people from there are looking about a global capital and the way how globalization works, and the need for writing our voices, writing our own experiences from within. Definitely, like the colonials were never interested in the people. They were interested in state building process. They were interested in establishing their trade and commerce monopoly in the region. And definitely, in that sense, their policy to the people, or their focus on the people, including education, other things, was very subsidiary. So even today, my take on to these scholars who come is, they are interested in other global structures and global capital, but what is their contribution for the people? Talking about Mr. Deka, I think he's involved in social movements and identity politics. And the way how you look at social movement, quite many books have also come from Nautis itself. And for me, if I have to look about the identity politics, I immediately consider it is an issue of a subjectivity. It's an issue of agency. It's an issue of intentionality that we are talking about. So identity politics is not simply a politics that one is playing. What I'm saying is identity politics, in that sense, if you look at that area, it's a very constitutive element. It's a constitutive element. So if you say identity, you don't simply think about eyes, souls, and the way they sing, their language. It is the agency, the subjectivity that's talking about. In that sense, our struggle is, how do I articulate these subjectivities? Do we have a naughty subjectivity? That is my question to you all. Do we have a notice of that kind? And we have an agency and subjectivity. If we have to try, prove that or engage on that level, we need to go down at the level of the history. I have to pitch at the level of the history to be able to recover the subjectivities. If at all I say that this field has a subjectivity, that is the question that we are talking about. Now, immediately you end into recovering the subjectivity through a historical method, then you land into a trap of, usually again, to the methodological trap, where what is history? On one side, you have an archival, paradigmic type of history, and on the other side, you have the oral type of history or narrative type of history. So the debate between the historical methods comes there again. So I think these are some of the important aspects as scientists and social scientists in particular try to look at notice. In fact, one can look at this larger methodological issues more than the political aspects. I would be interested in methodological issues like either we talk about history or the epistemologies that we are generally discussed. So those are more fundamental and needs to be understood. Otherwise, we would be talking, but we'll not be able to really talk at that level, at the foundational level. So definitely this thinking, little bit that I'm giving you as an introduction, and our speaker today is well-known, he's worked in this area, so I hope his speech will help us to think deeper and be able to help us to understand in a better manner. So with these few words, I request.
Perspective to it. I mean, I've come with some few slides, and as you can see, the title of actually before that, let me have a quick confession. And the title of the festival actually goes quite well with my presentation, because once Roderick contacted me and was requesting me to speak something on Northeast, one of the key words that actually came to my mind was this very word. Mosaic, because that is what Northeast actually eventually is. It is a very complex and fascinating mosaic, something that we are still trying to make sense of, or something perhaps is getting constantly produced and reproduced. So my lecture, I don't know whether I can call it a lecture, it is more of a, you can say, conversation, or some of this, some of the doubts I myself have, whether how to actually try to figure out or decode what we often refer to as the Northeast. Since when this word entered the terminology? When, what are the kind of the background to this whole category called Northeast? And how we are now using it so frequently and in a very, very casual way, and how one has to kind of be very aware and very conscious of using this category called Northeast, because it is like any other normative category. It has become a normative category, by the way, now. That's what I will argue in my lecture. Like any other normative category, it has a baggage and it comes with a history, right? And it's a history that is constantly being produced even now. So that will be the fundamental premise of my lecture or my talk today, and how to make sense of what we call Northeast and what it reflects. It reflects many things as methodologically, as Professor Alex rightly pointed, it's very crucial methodologically. Also, socio-politically, also how this whole usage of the
is always caught in something which is, I would say, some kind of cartographic kind of shifts.
You can see that how, you can see the whole imagination or the whole way Northeast has existed in a very complicated relationship with the so-called national imagination, and it keeps going through transition. Right, so the whole kind of idea that what India was in certain period and what it has become later, but you can see constantly the Northeast, the position of Northeast keeps changing, and especially interesting is the pre-partition map, the map of colonial British India. You can see the area that we call as Northeast today was again very much larger than today, and pre-colonial, I mean again that is a debatable, I know these maps are debatable, but to just show a kind of standard kind of projection of what India was at one point perhaps. So this kind of gives a rough idea of how what we define a region keeps going through kind of transition. Next. This is not that needed because of the audience, I guess, is very much informed of this. So, well, there are two slides. While I was going through some other works, I was trying to research on the available literature also. So there are two, this is one and we'll come to another. So some of the key government bodies, like this is from the website of Indira Gandhi National Center for Art, IGNC, as we know, is a central agency and that funds a lot of programs and activities to do with Northeast. So you can see some of the nomenclature, like Northeast as the land of seven sisters, right? So although officially things have changed, but some of the categories get fixed. Because as we know, Northeast is no longer seven, it's eight. Right, so how did it become eight? But officially, even in official documents, the projection is as land of seven sisters, because that is how normative categories gets fixed. Because as we know, in Northeast also, many of us are from there. We know there are a lot of, to give a lay example, a lot of business houses we will call the seven sisters, this and that. So the whole idea of seven sisters, which was almost part of some kind of even folklorish kind of background. But you know, now it has become eight, but even the government agencies are not still yet used to that. Next one. Well, so at the same time, we have the emergence of the region as a brand. Right? Northeast is also a brand now. More than anything, it is a brand actually, if you ask me. Right? Because academic validity is one thing, but the brand brandization, the branding of Northeast is actually very much done already. You have instances like this football club. Right, Northeast United, and you see how more than anything, these are the platform that actually is now powerfully building up this whole category of Northeast. And you have this online marketing shops and other kind of outlets which is actually aggressively marketing products from quote unquote Northeast. So it's a brand now. Right, next. But at the same time, you have the whole duality also at the same time, because it's just something that will define the region, as I will come to it later, that how protest and participation, right? Rejection and acceptance. These binaries are very much visible. You have instances, again, most people can relate to this instances of protest to do with allegation of racism, right? That discrimination based on looks and lifestyle, that is there, but at the same time, how the market is co-opted. At the same time, and you have a lot of talk about how Northeast attire and Northeast fashion is now being marketed in prominent fashion shows in India, right? And internationally also, outside also. So this whole contradiction defines the region at large. These are very crucial contradictions that one has to make sense of. Right, next. And because this is just the introduction, I'm trying to throw a lot of slides on you just to show the whole mismatch or some of this contradiction for Northeast. And this is again one of the slides that this was prepared by PwC. This is 2015 data, but I'm sure a lot of it will still make sense. That shows at a quick level how there are a lot of policy disconnects, right? Even that income, there are a lot of investment in the region, right? And but the outcome is low. So again, we'll have to look into that later on. So that why is it so? So again, another instance of, you know, this this is again from the side of NEC. That the Northeastern Council, which is supposed to be the nodal agency to, you know, regulate this development and funds. And you can see how one, in a way, can see some kind of very shoddy approach, and you can say, this is reflective of a larger malaise that, you know, within the website, if you want to actually access some information, most of the files will not open. Well, and this is it's the latest information. So what I'm trying to argue is that, of course, this can be a technical glitch, but what I'm trying to argue is that this is actually reflective of the larger state of affairs. That, you know, like, you one hand, when a market has taken over, the state is pumping money, but again, somewhere something is going wrong. Right? So we have to make sense of that, that what is going wrong. And after all, the whole category called Northeast, although it is established now very firmly, but what are the actual implications of that? Next. Okay, so this will be now the first part of the lecture, that let us try to understand the way state is actually looking at Northeast vis-a-vis how the Northeast as a category of eight states is actually interacting with the state. And this part, the focus is on state, because as we will argue, the state has been a fundamental actor in the whole kind of conceptualization of the category of Northeast. Let me mention what we call it, reign of exceptionalism, right? Because I take this, some people are already talking about it, one being this professor in sociology, he talks about it, state of exception. He borrows it from Carl Schmitt and people like Agamben, that how Northeast actually is put under a state of exception. And I would try to add some new elements as well here. And there are, the way historically people have, some of the scholars have argued that Northeast has been put in a very uneasy relationship with India from the very beginning, right? And I would call it three fundamental background, three fundamental historical baggage, if you would say. One is that it has been seen as the underbelly of Indian state. One is because the whole idea of the geopolitical location of Northeast. Now again, I would urge you to go back to the maps that we showed before, the pre-partition map, right? Because Northeast was part of a larger entity. It's actually existing in a transaction, right? Now people are calling it different things, like how Brooks said that it's the thing like Lucas policy, call it gateway to Southeast Asia. You know, it's no longer the frontier, it's become the gateway. But the important thing is to know that the historical baggage, that Northeast has been seen geopolitically very fragile, a very sensitive thing, you know, bounded by different other sovereign nation states from all sides. So that is the first anxiety, that is the first moment of anxiety. The second moment of anxiety is this whole issue of underdevelopment. That Northeast has been, although there are now some studies and statistics that argue that pre-independence, some of the states and regions have higher per capita income and economically in a much better condition. But although one has to acknowledge that economically, some of the performance of this region post-independence have been kind of a sense of a source of worry for the state, and that's why Indian state also have been wary of Northeast becoming a poor performer or dragging down the so-called Indian developmental story. So that was the second moment of anxiety. And the third moment of anxiety, which I would, so far I think not many people have called it a moment of anxiety, but I would see the third moment as this whole idea of the obscurity of culture or this cultural disconnectedness, right? Because, and in fact there are references to it. Even some scholar like Udayan Mishra, who has worked many years on issues of Northeast India, even he makes a comparison, although he does not call it so. He says how Assamese case and Naga case are very different because Assam still in some senses are connected to so-called quote-unquote Indic civilization. Right, so this whole thesis of Indic civilization and how other states of Northeast and other areas of Northeast falls outside Indic civilization. So that's the important thesis that we'll have to bring into this debate, that how this kind of unease at this cultural alienation or this kind of failure on part of the policymakers to make sense of the region culturally. So Vedian Elvin is a very good example that how, that is why the whole thesis of protection is the how Elvin thought that it's better to kind of leave people to their own device. But this, so So this cultural alien cultural kind of projection is also crucial too. It becomes a triangle type, the three moments of anxiety. And next. And you come across these very interesting tidbits, these interesting insights from, because I think it's important for academicians also to read about from people who are actually posted as in the defense or in other services, because it also shows us kind of where the policies are coming from. So also there is this whole concern that how a population which is culturally different, geopolitically sensitive, as well as economically disorganized, needs to be kind of, in a way, put under some kind of paternalistic, you can say, protection, some kind of a protection, protective kind of gaze. Next. So again, this is how I would say the broad parameters of how Northeast has been turned into objects of policy making, right? Sabir Kumar Das, who's a political scientist, have actually talks about this objectification of Northeast, and he says that how Northeast has actually from the very beginning had a very problematic relation, and we can now figure out certain kind of, and this is not one scholar, many people have looked into it in last many decades, as already professor pointed out, this whole idea of frontier has been one of the key way to kind of define Indian response, that how it is some kind of unruly frontier, right? And then the second one is, many of you might be knowing this famous or other infamous statement by Home Minister Sardar Patel of that time, when there was this whole report of some trouble in Manipur regarding the merger. So he's supposed to have, you know, come up with a very loose statement, something to the order of it should be a basic law and order problem. So again, many people point out that that has been one of the central theme of the initial state response to problems in Northeast India, to treat it as a law and order problem. So this behind this is the whole idea of people being very simple. So that is again one of the contradiction that we have of how many a times Indian state as well as the Indian society also looks at Northeast that in extremes, that either it will be something very fascinating or something very fearsome, right? This whole contrast again is there, that you have to treat people who are very simple but not yet ready for modern laws and modern kind of system of governing. So you need the army, or at least the famous essay by Sanjeev Bora, many of you would have recalled, he says generals as governors, right? Because how in Northeast there is a whole tradition of army generals, retired army generals being posted as governor. So he argues that this is again symbolic of a larger kind of a policy mindset, that you would treat somebody from an army or defense background to be the ceremonial head of state in those states. So he does have a point, although the symptom is actually much larger than that, I will argue. Then there are certain theoretical kind of frame that one can use, perhaps, like one is the idea of how, you know, the state, these are connected, of course, always are connected, how the state assumes the role of a caregiver and denies anyone else that space. So my speaker, this speaker for tomorrow, Dr. Malam, I think he will talk mostly on these issues, because he is going to talk about conflict and vis-a-vis the whole idea of nationality movements in Northeast. So he will probably talk more on this, but the idea is that how the space is actually denying that same role to other groups, right? And this is the, that is why it is said the Northeast is almost like it's condemned, that they will have to kind of have to be the role of caretaker, meaning they have to receive the care, right? This is like almost kind of some condemnation. Then this is the other thing, is that again I was tempted to quote this provocative statement by Barry Anderson. Some of you must have read his Indian Ideology that came out a couple of years back. And he received a lot of flack for saying this, which is of course, because of course factually you cannot say, because it is implemented in states which is technically which is within the Hindu fold, like Assam and Manipur is the example. But I guess the larger point he is making is that it is true that the whole idea that how you can actually continue with some law which almost like creates some kind of as a law of exception
to areas which is traditionally not within the quote-unquote mainstream. So they have always existed at the fringes of the nation state. Kashmir and Northeast, these are the two places we point out that exist at the margins. So how this law is, again, he is trying to argue that laws like Armed Forces Special Powers Act, ASPA, also is kind of reflective of that very idea of kind of putting somebody at the margin and kind of giving that treatment. Next. So moving to the focus on state, why I'm arguing that we have to, when we talk about state and when we talk about conflict and ethnicity, we have to bring the state to our central investigation. Modern state is very crucial, and because, you know, that is where actually its character of the state influences the way ethnic movement progresses. That is not to argue at the same time that ethnic movements won't have their own dynamics, like internal identity formation and yearning for a space for articulating that identity. But as we have seen in Northeast time and again, the character of the state, the way state has negotiated with this movement has been very, very important. Right, next. Now we have seen that how state has been the target as well as sponsor or antagonist of the different social movements. So this is very crucial, because sometimes we tend to have a very simplistic reading of the state. Right, because movements that has been outside the framework of state at some point, it has been seen that at some point they have entered the framework, and what has been outside institutions have become institutionalized at later points. So this is very crucial for Northeast to remember that the boundaries between state and the boundaries between institution and what is not institutionalized is very fluid. So this fluidity of boundary we have to be very careful about when we talk about Northeast. And again, there are broadly, if we can draw some broad kind of pattern, there are two primary ways the social movements and state are negotiating in Northeast, or you can say how the interest or the objective of the state has been influenced. One is the whole overriding, you can say almost overriding or overarching context of national security. That is one standard reading of any conflict resolution or any kind of negotiation of any social movement will have this overarching context of national security. But equally, there is another factor which is at work here, that is the context of ethno-nationalism. So roughly, most of the social movements and different conflicts in this region can be explained between as a tension between these two, as how these two interact, as how these two kind of negotiates with each other, and overlaps also at many a point. And we'll come to it with more detail now. Next. So now let me take some time here, because I was just trying to go through the different available literature as well as my own fieldwork, and just trying to make sense of, if you want to explain how the ethnic other, because again we have to be very mindful here, because there are others within others, right? Northeast is a land of identities, as we often are very quick to point out, but there are otherizations within the others. And again, I would say how we have to bring the state in a very, we have to interrogate the role of the state here and see the different ways it can be taken. First, again, one American sociologist, Bethany Lassina, she had come out with an essay, one quite brilliant essay, and which some other people later on have expanded on that essay, like people like Sanjay Golkar. She calls that there is this approach that Indian state is often seen as adopting when it comes to Northeast in conflict situations. She calls it a safety valve approach. Right? By that she means that many a times you would go for some kind of local alliance, or what she calls ethnocracy. That's the term she uses, ethnocracy, that some rule by a local ethnic elite, that you will be okay with that, even knowing that it might temporarily go for some kind of law and order erosion in the larger interest of keeping some of the so-called national security measures intact. Like one very, I think, good example of that will be, say, the area called Boroland in Assam, BTC, Boroland Territorial Council, which was formed in 2003 and formed after one
accord with the militant groups who are fighting the an insurgent war for a separate state. There was an accord. Subsequently, there was a creation of the Territorial Council under 6th Schedule of Indian Constitution, and the militants, the former militants, formed a political entity, political party, and they came to power. That how it shows that the state is always looking for an outlet through which, even at the cost of undermining some of the democratic rights in the particular area, it can be okay with it in the interest of maintaining the larger national security kind of scenario. Again, as we say, national security being one of the overarching factor that I mentioned. How the Indian state is always thinking that since it's a sensitive area, there are foreign, quote-unquote foreign players involved. So even if it means some kind of undermining of democratic norms and rights for the people involved, minorities, especially the ethnic minorities or the minorities in the region, we have to go with that ad hocism, or I can say some temporary resolution of the conflict in that interest. So that is safety one. And another argument which I would call the entrapment argument. Now, entrapment argument is, it has some kind of a history, the way the societies or the region, the states in Northeast unfolded post 1947. And it's a longer argument. I mean, it will need, I'm sure also this argument has many kind of different elements into it. But briefly speaking, it's about people's rights over resources. Now, how in Northeast, because we are very much tying up our right to resource to our identities, what happens is that you get entrapped with your identities and you get divided from within the same region. People get divided from each other. So people are not only entrapped from community to community, they are also entrapped from as a group and the resource. The Forest Rights Act especially, right? There are a lot of debates about it, that whether how the natural resources and the forest, how far it can be used by people. And many times we have seen that how different communities assert their rights over resources almost as part of the identity assertion. So again, people get entrapped in that, and that leads to a lot of conflict. And the state also has maintained some kind of a dubious position on that. Third one is connected again very much with the other one for autochthony matter, or so-called, nowadays we call it as the whole movement of indigenous rights. So this is a very curious word, I find, because again, same like the word Northeast has been used by different group to mean different thing. And I might sound like the, I don't know, devil's advocate here, but I find the whole, because this is the catchword in Northeast at this moment. Right? Indigenous rights, it's the catchword now. And almost everybody is claiming to be indigenous. Right? I mean, it's very difficult. If you actually seriously look into the literature of indigenous rights in Northeast, you will actually not find a very definitive word, because it has a very, the application of it is very loose. It has a very different name, it has a very different implication when you talk it as part of international jurisprudence. And that is where it is coming from, right? It's coming from a certain discourse of international rights. And there are certain scholars, and as already mentioned, B.G. Carlson himself being one of the early votaries of how to bring it to Northeast. This whole idea of discourse of indigenous rights has been now brought into Northeast. But it's very curious to see that how, again, this whole idea of indigenous rights have been used in very contradictory ways. But the way state now, in this, coming back to this context vis-a-vis indigenous right or the autochthony banner vis-a-vis the role of the state, is that what happens is that now in Indian Northeast, especially in the areas where we have provision of special autonomy rights, right, the state has actually accepted some kind of linkages and normalized those linkages between ones geopolitical terrain and identity. So this identity and geopolitics have been almost normalized and legalized, which has a lot of consequences. Right? And we have seen these consequences can be very brutal and very violent. Because now you're assuming that some particular person or some particular community has some kind of natural, quote-unquote natural, and legal rights over a certain area, and because of this whole discourse of indigenous rights. So it has also led to some explosive kind of consequences. And we have seen a lot of riots and a lot of violent clashes. So, and how indigenous has become very usually loosely, right? It has become a strategy again. And the final one is that, again, how the ballot and bulletin office goes together. How elections have been platforms for manipulating identities. And we have seen how ethnic identities often is seen that it gets incentivized or disincentivized after election. So elections are either an assertion or an act of avenging, right? So there are a lot of examples where elections have been used for elections, or lack of election has been used for that. And while later when I come to the other part, I'll show some statistics how it shows that how people might be participating in election, but at the same time they might be trying to undermine that very system itself. Next. So this is one photo from Assam that came back, came out a couple of months, maybe a year back. One of the communities that have been trying to, as some of you will know, that six communities are now agitating for getting a scheduled tribe status, right? And it shows that there are this construction of identities, right? Which again, nobody is sure where is it coming from, because we have a very loose kind of politics of representation going on here, and it's mostly based, as Charles Taylor says, that it's all about misrecognition from others. So you're also always answering back to somebody. Nobody's sure who is that, but you are trying to talk back to the structures of power. But in that, you replicate, you end up replicating certain stereotypes without being aware of. Next. Well, so that is one. So what I have said so far is mostly fits with the existing discourse that we all know that state in India is actually, you know, creating divisions, and people are responding, there are social movements who are claiming for indigenous rights. All that is fine. But now there is something at the same time, equally crucial, maybe more significant, which we are not talking so much yet, and which we need to really, really be very observant about, is what I would call a second coming of identity formation, which is happening outside the region, which is happening outside Northeast. And it is very crucial because this is something that shows it has some implication for the identity thesis, the identity formation thesis in their respective societies, that is the formation and emergence of fluid and adjacent identities. And one of the way, perhaps politics, the way politics will be done will be changed in a significant way in Northeast is because of this whole issue of out-migration. Right? Because although in Northeast, a lot of identity politics, a lot of ethno-nationalism is built around the whole idea of son of the soil, or when we call that autochthony banner, when we talked about the son of the soil thesis. At the same time, a huge number of working population, young students and other people are always migrating out of the region. It's a rising graph, right, as we know. And I mean, most of us do belong to that category, right? We are people who are studying here or working here. So what does it mean for the identity discourse in Northeast India? And I'll give you a very small, very recent example, a meeting I went back last week. And most of you would know that how Nagaland right now is going through serious turmoil. Turmoil, but at the same time, it can be a defining juncture about this reservation, women's reservation, 33% women's reservation. And in Delhi, a group of Naga scholars, young Naga scholars, they are actually taking the initiative to hold a lot of roundtable conferences and bringing different opinions to one discussion table. So there are interventions that has been made. Right, so this is one example through which there are a lot of ways in which identities which otherwise is seen as very exclusive or very rigid or very defined, as in well settled and defined, is getting challenged. Out-migration is one, which also is leading to shared living experiences. And now we have to come to this whole debate. Now this is a big debate because the moment you talk about racism in India, people are divided. Right? A lot of people will kind of define it in some different way, not as racism. But in this particular lecture, what I'm trying to say, how race has become some kind of uniting trope, some kind of a platform where different people are actually uniting and I'm sure many of you as students also have had the occasion to kind of come under some banner. Right? In Delhi it happened a lot in the last 2 years. There are a lot of banners which actually try to talk about a collective identity. And as again Professor Alex was just talking about, is there a Northeastern subjectivity? Right? So these are, I think, occasions. The debate is that how far it is sustainable or what are the actual kind of, you know, connecting thoughts of the subjectivity. But the subjectivity is emerging through this kind of, you know, these different experiences. And we have emergence of what I would call, quote unquote, as urban ghettos, because again, people who have been in Delhi would know. I don't know about Bombay so much, but states in cities like Delhi and Bangalore, for sure there are these places which is kind of almost popularized. There's a strong presence of students and working people from Northeast India, and these places have become now some kind of new places where people are there because of some shared lifestyle, food habits. Right. And you know the infamous booklet that came out from Delhi Police against this particular food called akhuni, which is like another fermented dish. So, I mean, these are very important things, and Dolly Kikon has written a very nice essay on that. She calls it fermenting modernity. Right. It's very, I mean, these are things that we have to be very aware of that. You see how state actually creeps in defining even what you have to eat and what you cannot eat and what you eat. Right, and this spaces are now new spaces, because although people back home might be very divided, back in Northeast maybe on community lines people can be very divided, but these are the new spaces where people are staying as urban dwellers. Right, and in urban dwellers you can see it's like a very interesting scenario, because you're giving up some identity but you're again at the same time assuming some new identity. It's maybe too early to say that whether this will be an identity, but again, identities are like that, isn't it? Identity is always in flux, and it has a, maybe it has a temporal value also. Not everything has to have a final meaning. Maybe like these identities that are actually in the making now, the identities that are being instrumentalized, because all identities are instrumentalized, end of the day. So it's only a debate that whether the debate is about, I think, the connotations of these identities, but it is definitely there that there are this new kind of the Northeastern subject that is kind of slowly emerging on these platforms, on these different platforms of food, on these platforms of shared lifestyle. And also, again, Duncan McDougall, he would did a very good ethnographic work. I think that is the only work, and recently, very recently, last week, the answer has come out with another. These are the works on life of migrant workers from Northeast who are there in different parts of different Indian metros. And how Duncan talks about this whole issue of this cultural capital, the cosmopolitan cultural capital that the young people from Northeast are either seem to have or they do have, that is that access to certain global culture. And you can say K-pop, right? K-pop is a big thing. Now if you go to any concert in Delhi is having this K-pop concert, and you can see there's a huge presence and participation from people from Northeast India. And this is a very, very characteristic that makes them very attractive to new global capital or the new market that is emerging in India. And you see people working in different sectors and malls and all that. So there is an edge, right? And the idea is that what Duncan is talking about is that because of which they can kind of maybe at one point the city factor that is seen as a hindrance, that a Northeast identity that is seen as frontier dwellers, maybe one can overcome this in this new, through these new corridors, through this new cultural capital that has come up. Right? Next. So the larger theoretical question here is that in Northeast, is there a politics of difference possible? Because the way the classical takes Stuart Hall being a pioneer on it, he talks about how identities cannot only be about interest. Because the way identity is talked about, and here I would like to, you can say, critique or contradict James Scott, because one of the problems with Scott, I feel, is that, I mean, he's romanticized a lot and he's seen as an anarchist. Okay? Many people in Northeast like Scott because Scott is seen as some kind of an anarchist who's giving Northeast some kind of a voice back, because he talks about the art of not being governed and how you can always evade the government, right, like the Highland politics and all that. But the problem is that because then identity is always tied up to interest, a particular community interest, and that you are negotiating your identity, always keeping in mind your exclusive interest. So it has the slope, that you can see there is a slippery slope. This discourse then can very easily become the very identity oriented, you can say exclusive identity oriented discourse. Against this, people like Stuart Hall has been talking about that it is also about solidarity. And to acknowledge that one's identity is subjective. Right? So it is position, place, and it's contextual. So is it possible that in Northeast this kind of understanding can it emerge very soon because of this adjacent identities? Because as once I was talking to one friend and he made a very interesting remark. He said that although from Northeast there are so many people in Delhi and most people are aware and we criticize and we grieve a lot about the role of the state, central government and of Delhi. But the irony is that Delhi is the only place, or Delhi as in the metros are the only place that makes sure that people in Northeast come together and even fall in love with each other, which is not possible. I mean, it's a very political statement, right? Because these spaces also have that utility, or they are doing that function. That function that to show that how identities are very shared. The shared identity can emerge perhaps from outside the region. So that is one. Next. Now, I would like to talk about a bit about this kind of the other part of the lecture, is that let's talk a little bit about the student and youth activism in the region. But end of the day, since we talk about people working outside or staying outside, we need to focus on these student groups and youth groups, as they are the ones, they are very much actively involved in the articulation of these identities, if not the formation, at least the articulation. And this we can skip, maybe we can go through quickly, because most of us would know the history of Assam movement, right? That was the time that student leaders have directly from the university campus, they went to assembly. Like say one night they were students staying hostel, and next day they went to assembly as chief minister. So that, many people argue that shows them some kind of a model to student politics in the region, that how we can actually enter the corridors of power from the platform of student politics. And student movement soon became very ethnicized, because it became these different social blocs that was quote-unquote represented or claimed to be represented by different student groups. And the third one, why it is perpetual, is that this whole idea of that I told you, this whole new reality is that there are people who are always moving out of the region, this opening up of the communication channels, this gap, this perpetual gap between the aspiration and the reality. So, of course, communication has brought a lot of change. So, these are the ways in which student activism remains relevant. Because many times I face this question, because my PhD work is on student activism. I face this question that almost everybody knows that student groups are corrupt and they are doing on behalf of certain parties or some class interest. So why they are still relevant? Why student groups are still seen as some social actors or relevant actors? These are this complex kind of reasons that how they build some networks. They are capable or they are successful in building some networks through which they can sustain their activism. Next. These are some final photo in this photo. Okay, this was again just a quick fieldwork photo. I can see how student groups have the legitimacy to the extent that these are this group of home guards. When I was interviewing some of the student leaders, this group of home guards who came up because they were doing some agitation that time for regularization and salary. So the social legitimacy is there, what I'm trying to say, that they are the boys who can get work done. So we need to know, we need to understand more this legitimacy. So these are some of the figures that I did one study 2 years back, where I was interviewing students from, this was the picture I didn't know. So this was a picture I was talking about, that some home guards, they were trying to make them talk to Vasu or some students in there to show the legitimacy, that it shows the legitimacy. Next. Well, so these are some of the figures that I did one study in 7 university campuses I visited, and I collected samples. There was a questionnaire framed
in association with CSDS and Hindu Center for Politics and Public Policy. So there was this trying to know basically how young people with university campuses in North East, how do they look at phenomena of election and protest. So some of the findings are quite revealing. One is that you can see the people who participate in protests, and we define protest as like, you know, going against authority, right? It might be local authority or police or even risking arrest. So how is one in some kind of protest activity? Next. Yeah, this was again a file photo. It will be for many of you might be very familiar and nothing special or nothing very significant, but for some other people, especially when I showed it to students in their university, they were quite shocked because it is not imaginable for many that there will be a army armored vehicle very normally moving around in the campus, stationed in the campus. But this is just to show the militarization, the extent of militarization and making sense of protest. And next. Again, no surprises here, right? I mean, I was saying how a lot of people are migrating out. There is a huge percentage of people who are quite sure that they would not mind coming out. So that leaves me, then you can see the contrast. So there are so many people willing to come out all the time. And again, there are people, there's new groups are very particular about identity and keeping the boundaries of their respective places very protected. So you can see that there is this people trying to come out and settle in new societies, but you are at the same time, you know, trying to have this very strong position on the indigenous and, you know, outsider, insider. I can skip this maybe on the well, maybe go back once. This is again trying to show the contradiction in student scenario, how at the same time we have in globally there were a lot of upsurges. You know that there are people who are students who are organizing activities through Facebook and Twitter, and there was this Arab Spring around that. And at the same time, I found it interesting, there was this event in Assam where there was this particular student group. They were demanding that Facebook should be banned because they said that it has insulted the community. And there was a certain post by somebody, making some derogatory comments. So there was a huge mobilization. They were burning Zuckerberg's photo and all that. And some people were asked this question. And I mean, see, this basically is trying to show that we have to be very, when we talk about student activism and student politics also, we have to be aware of these differentiations. Right, that activism happens at different level. But of course, things have changed since then a lot. This was again a photo of Guwahati. There were certain incidents, and you can see traditional students, youth were kind of sidelined because, again, this is so-called quote-unquote new activism that has taken the floor. Right, people organize over Facebook or Twitter, so you can see the changes are also coming there. Right, how technology is actually making inroads and how will it change the traditional youth politics and student politics, that is the question. Next. So there is this, I began with this thing that called talking about this dual narratives, right, protest and participation. So you can see the figures there. So the people who are very, very dissatisfied and they have taken part in different protests and different movements are at the same time almost similar number of people have been always voting regularly. And although they also don't have a very rosy picture about election. So when you talk about what is the predominant image that comes to mind, and most people will talk about corruption and violence. But still they are participating in the system or in election. So this goes with the previous kind of position that we were talking about, how there are a lot of people up because they're coming out and they are now also participating. But at the same time, it does not mean the element of protest is gone. So this participation and protest is kind of coexisting. So which we have to remember, and when we talk about Northeast, one has to be wary of talking in binaries.
And not the whole idea of Northeast should be integrated as part of India. Right? This integration and equality has some subtle difference, and it was very much visible in that time. And also is that the collaboration with quote-unquote again mainstream civil society, because most of this youth organizations were doing some joint protest and demonstration and all, and a lot of you could see that a new partnership is developing, right? So this is a new phase now, right? Because people are now talking about constitutional language equality, and at the same time they are also in partnership with civil society groups in India. So when you talk about youth activism,
we are at one go, we have groups who are talking about different kind of indigenous rights and different kind of exclusive identity. Also we have these groups who are talking about new kind of new forms of partnership. But the crucial point is that they are not strictly divided, because most of them would have some kind of deadly branch of the same students area. So we have to think of, you know, this making these connections. Next. So this will be almost like a concluding part, and most of it has been, some of it has been covered already by the chair. So this, they are saying that, again, that whole idea of developmentalism, that development will come and Northeast will be now opened up, right, so-called opened up, so the identity discourse will change. That is one assumption. And Bertil Lindner, who has been writing for many, many decades, is a Swedish journalist, if I'm right, or Spanish, I think Swedish. He was based in Burma. He has this book called The Great Gap East. Very interesting book, that where he tracks this whole evolution of this. You can say almost like the legacy of locust policy, you can say. So he talks about how India, this is where the most of the new kind of development, or the way Northeast policy is articulated now, from look east, and now they're calling it act east. So this policy is actually seen as a great game that is being played between the superpowers like China and India, where everyone else basically is a pawn in this, right? So that is one way to define it. And again, as many people are calling it, from frontier to corridor, so they will become corridors of development, from highway to headquarters, because again, Northeast has been highways are very symbolic in Northeast. Most of us will know the ones from there, that how everything is done around highway. Highways are not only highways, but they are almost political channels, right? So I mean, whoever has control of the highway is an upper age. So you are already in the hierarchy of identity, you're always up there. If you happen to be based on some highway, you're already privileged. So that is there. So you can see how post-colonial state making is coming here, right? Because the highway just happened to be there, because when British came and they built the highway, of course you can keep going back and back in history, and people should read this very fascinating account of first the British expedition to the Naga Hills. It's very interesting, because you had the Assamese guy as an advisor, and one hand, and the Meitei guy as another advisor, and it's hilarious, actually not hilarious, but it is hilarious, the kind of way he's advised, the British colonialist advised, that you should take this route because these tribes are like this, and if you go this way, you will not be able to go. So that's how the highway came up, okay, at some point, if you go back to history. And see, now it changes the whole political dynamics of Northeast, because that's how, I mean, we are, that's why I often say that Northeast, like, actually it's a region that is living, you can say, 1,000 years in a lifetime. Because, you know, like, these are recent, actually, things, that this construction of highway now, you know, this, so Lucas, again, there are some people who kind of a bit skeptical that whether Lucas will be another instance where it will just end up being some kind of a highway, that's all. Because I could recall that when Rajdhani Express came to my place, Dibrugarh, when Rajdhani Express came, it was a big, like, people had a lot of expectation that there's a fast train coming from Delhi and all that. It changed communication, that is true. But imagine for most of the other areas, villages in Assam, for them, Rajdhani Express is only like a, it's like a blurry line that passes. All they see is something that quickly zooms by, passes by, right? So life is very much same otherwise. So will Lucas also be like that? And in China, like Yunnan, you know, the Yunnan vision in China is that China takes pride calling it like the ethnic museum of China, like that is where most of the ethnic minorities of China are from. So Northeast, will it also become some kind of Yunnan of India, like where you preserve and you showcase, like the mosaic, that's what we're saying, the mosaic of Northeast, that it is a very fascinating mosaic, but how much participation actually the region will have. And one instance some people did point out, and I also wrote about it, was that cross-border, so-called or quote-unquote cross-border attack on Burma by Indian Army, that another surgical strike which didn't got that highlighted like the other surgical strike. But there was this whole talk about this cross-border strike of Indian Army into Myanmar, right, which was broken as a breaking news by the defense minister in Delhi. And in chief ministers of Manipur, Assam, Nagaland, all were completely taken aback. They have no clue. like the local ministers and local authorities had no clue of this. So is it reflective of the larger designs to come and do this policy? Because you will have to have some stakeholders at local level. So that is one, these are the kind of implication problem, but methodologically there are people who support it, right? There are Kellner who talks about this methodological nationalism has to be broken out of. Then there are Van Schendel who talks about some departitioning of the region. Well, Van Schendel in fact deals a lot with cartography and he brings up very interesting maps and also shows that he has a very interesting aspect of where is Northeast. So I think it's not published yet. He presented in a conference, but it was very interesting. Where is Northeast? He talks about departitioning of the region. So he said that, and it's true that partition happened not only along the western front, but partition also affected it, Northeast in a big way. So departitioning Northeast, the Lucas scanning be one. And some people say the situation of imagined geography that Samir Das talks about, that Northeast has to now come out of the imagined geography. We are talking about the Northeast being part of Southeast Asia, but we have to now actually implement it policy level. And there is another very interesting paper that came up just a couple of months back, right? This is from Nehu, this two scholars, Jyotokuni and Luters. So they talk about actually another very interesting factor which we often forget. They talk about phenomena of internal borderlands. So we are talking a lot about Northeast Lucas policy as a Northeast as a region, but we forget that it is highly fragmented internally. And they talk about, we won't go into details, but he talks about fiscal boundaries, legal boundaries, even liquor, which is very interesting, I'll come to it, and emotional boundaries. We know the ILP, internet permit, how within Northeast also people need a permit to visit one place from the other. And the liquor boundary, he says that how, because of this theological, you can say, you can almost call it a theological Christian concerned that many states are now following prohibition. And this also is some kind of a, almost like a boundary making, because as some of us who know the place, we know how there are these border towns, right, who are extremely commercial and filled with liquor stores, because people who cannot drink in their hometown will quickly come out and have a swing and go back. And this place is a tribe, right, and these are the commercial hubs now. Because of that. And these are also some kind of borderlands now. There are a lot of borderlands within Northeast. So when you talk about Lucas, how to also at the same time, you know, be aware of this internal borderlands. That is also very important. Then these are just basic points about Lucas and that what are the so-called strengths and what are the weaknesses and how Lucas is seen as some kind of game changer. They are saying it will be a game changer, but next. So, but my last part of my presentation, the conclusion, will question some of these assumptions or the possibilities. And it's some kind of a resource frontier that Northeast has become. And this picture was taken by me. I visited this Longland in Nagaland some months back. And you can see this you can see this coal mines. Right, this open cast mining and other kind of mines, which has now become a big industry. Of course, just unorganized, but still quite a big industry. And because there are a lot of involvement with new actors, new kind of non-state actors. So things are complicated already. You have issues of migration because of cheap labor. There are people from other places who are being engaged in this extraction. And this again becomes connected then in a very convoluted way, it becomes connected to the identity discourse. Right? And one very brief example without naming the organization, when I went to one of these mines, there was this, these mines are being kind of, you can say, leased out. Of course, in the name of the village council, but everybody knows who are the real players who are leasing it out, by the non-state actors. And the village councillor, the Gaungura, is again, it's overlapping of identities and authority, you see. He is also the headman, one of the headmen in the local church. And again, being very devout Christian, they are not, alcohol is strictly kind of prohibited and all that. But it's a very different picture in night time, because there are a lot of laborers who are working for very cheap labor, like very less money. And you can see the very same people will be very happily distributing liquors, because they are saying we have to keep the laborers happy and interested in this. We have to, you know, this is just a business thing that we have to keep people happy and these laborers are here and all that. So you can see how things are very overlapping. At the same time, this ideology and identity at one level, but this taxation and this kind of different kind of approaches when it comes to business. Next. So I call it some kind of a litmus test of indigenous, right, indigeneity. Is that how, you know, Bruno Latour has this defining work. He talks about geostory. He says that we did not only talk about cultural history or natural history, but we talk about something called geostory, which is something that which you already, professor already talked about, P.G. Carlson, that he talks about how Northeast has become resource frontier. And he talks about the whole idea of kind of how people themselves are alienated, that they don't have their ability to interact meaningfully to the ecological habitat. But again, I would say that Carlson also romanticizes people in a way. Because who are the people end of the day? Because if you talk about people who are actually involved in this extraction of resources, these are the representatives of all kinds. Talk about government representative or the non-state representatives. So, it's, of course, it's a dominant coalition. I would say instead of talking about people, you should talk about a dominant coalition of these groups, which are very overlapping. Right? These different authorities are overlapping. It's a collective design where this ecology and you know, this extraction is going on. So basically, reference to the natural has to come back in Northeast. So if you're talking about indigenous rights, so it has to be put in this context. Without this context, if you talk about indigenous rights in Northeast, you will be having a very, the consequences will be different and it will be very superficial. Next. So yeah, these are the conditions I was talking about that boundary between nature and culture has to be brought back. Often in Northeast we talk about traditional knowledge. Now we have to be more aware of what are the positive takeaways from traditional knowledge. We need to talk more and more of those examples. Right? And environmental politics has to become more crucial. The reason I'm talking about is that because I work with the youth and student group, and one of the only platforms that I have seen in the last few years that has the potential to bring people from different students and youth group together is the ecological and environmental struggles. Because there is a realization that end of the day that is the overarching context to all the identities. See, there is a dam, the anti-dam movement in Assam going on now. That is the dam being built in lower Son city, that is just where Arunachal starts and Assam ends. Assam starts and Arunachal ends. So there are this dam which has suddenly become a symbolic kind of reminder, because the dam is like in a higher plane. So if the dam breaks and the water comes, it will not particularly look for a missing village or an Ahom village or this village, that village, right? That water will transcend over identities. Right? So that transcendence of identities is very symbolic. And this environmental reminders of this different kind of, you know, this politics of, you know, around development and environment has, I think, one of the few potential kind of platforms where identities can be kind of meaningfully collaborate, they can collaborate meaningfully. Although there are different dynamics within this, there are people who would now they claim more compensation in case any problem, they are saying because we are the indigenous, we need more compensation. That is of course there, and this is inevitable because end of the day it is based on that idea of indigeneity, right? But at the same time there are probably these grounds of solidarity, and from there maybe things can go to a different level. So that is one wishful, you can say, or optimistic kind of takeaway. So next. So this is a very, I mean, this is the last slide, and I found that this poem is very, very, it talks about a lot of things. As many of you must have heard or read about it already by this Mizo poet. And she talks about, it's not the title, it's not the, that is my title, the perennial other. The poem is called, What Does an Indian Look Like? Right? So, end of the day, Northeast is now becoming almost like a buzzword, right? Every institutes are supposed to have a society that is Northeast society. I mean, the university has it's a rule from the ministry, and there are festivals happening. And as we talk today, actually, is the first day of one festival in Assam called Rongali Festival, which is advertised as the biggest festival of Northeast India. That is a routine. So there are a lot of these festivals that are actually, you know, now happening, and people are talking so much about Northeast. But at the end of the day, again, a lot of grey areas remain, right? So these are the broad ways which in which I tried to make some sense. I don't know whether I confused people more or I made sense, because it was very broad, I know, but I think at some point we cannot avoid these broad parameters, because otherwise we always talk about a lopsided or one-sided story. Well, notice, I think, is a story that has many, many sides to it. It is something that is still unfolding, right? And the way Northeast India interacts with the idea of India, I would say, will determine in a long way how India itself evolves, or the nation making in India itself evolves in the long run. So when we talk about Northeast India, we are not only talking about a region, we are talking about idea of India itself, how it is responding. Thank you so much.
Just to make one comment before we proceed into questions. As students, as social science students, what is important is, as I focused in the beginning, you know, it is at the level of the methodology. It is an epistemological question that you need to train your mind before you end up you're taking into granted what is given to you. So you should be able to have a mind where you are able to engage it at the level of the epistemology, the level of the how things are arrived at, how knowledge are produced. In that sense, generally there are, in the latest, in epistemology, people are talking about usually epistemologies of the north, epistemologies of the south. Epistemologies of the north are usually what you can call it, positivism, colonial, you know, that kind of an objectification, arriving at a knowledge through objectification. You see, that's the way how I think Deka is, or that's just somewhere. But there is another epistemologies which are emerging. You see, we consider it as epistemologies of the South. And within that, there are again epistemologies, there's ways and means of arriving. But here, one is not talking about objectification, but suppose how can you get into the skin of the object that you are studying? These are two ways of looking at things. Now, if I have to study this bottle, I can observe it as an object here, or can I get into this skin and to talk about this and become a part of this, you know, become a part of this bottle itself. So the second part will talk about an epistemology or arrival of a truth or description of a reality that you are talking about only when you have been able to enter into the skin of the person that you are studying, or the object that you are studying. And in fact, the best example is shamanism. Now, why I'm saying this? Northeast is a very complex place. And the first thing it requires a very methodological sensitivity. A methodological sensitivity. There are life processes. When somebody is talking about their identity, when somebody is talking about their land, when somebody is talking about their land, there is a reason behind. One needs to understand that reason. Why they are still talking about their culture? Why they are still holding on to identities? What is the meaning of that? One needs to get into that before you go into analyzing various aspects. That's a very important aspect for us researchers, because Northeast as a place now, it's a considered sometimes as a disturbed area. So many ideas have come, market has come, and these are all, in fact, the product of the state itself. So first thing, methodologically, as Deka has also pointed out, methodological nationalism, one needs to critique that first. Before, of course, things have to go simultaneously, but while keeping sensitive, my method has to be sensitive to the lives of the people. It's a question of a life. I also need to engage with the state. What are the structures that constantly shapes and makes people dance? That is an important question that needs to come together, otherwise you will miss the point. And in the process, this is one thing that I'm always careful about. any study that you do, any conclusion that you arrive at, should not be an affirmation of a subjugation of someone, or of you killing someone, or usually it's discussed as epistemological genocide. Usually or epistemological injustice. These are concepts which are given here, which you and me need to be very sensitive in that sense. So I think Professor has highlighted very clearly the dynamics, internal processes, and shown to us what actually is not is. You know? And one needs to carefully look at these things. Of course, it is his way of presenting. You and me are looking at it, needs to understand this. And definitely one needs to move towards understanding life, survival, you know. In fact, doing the research at the foundational level where humanity is put into a certain place. So that's my concern actually as a researcher and also a person coming from there. Because as he is talking about what we are talking today, the latest in political economy, people talking about disembedding societies, disembedding subsistence into culture, you know, human beings into labor, you know, that kind of, a kind of a killing actually. It's genocide in that sense. So one has to be very careful in this analysis and to be, then only at the end of the day, our aim is to look at life, survival, dialogue, peace. I still prefer these words. I people say, why are you talking about the dialogue when people are not, you know, these things are, you are not political enough. But I think some of us have to still talk, even if in this kind of situation. So we need to still propagate this kind of values. I question ethno-nationalism at the level of ethics, for example. What are the ethical considerations for any ethno-nationalism? Can I say that my nationalism means that I will kill someone? Or I will have to eliminate some ethnic group? These are sensitive questions one is to look at. And of course, it has to come from understanding first what is the state and what the state has done to us.